वेलकम बैक। नाउ आवर नेक्स्ट टॉपिक इज हिस्टोरियोग्राफी इन मॉडर्न पीरियड। हियर वी स्पेशली टॉक अबाउट द हिस्ट्री विच वॉज रिटन इन द 20th सेंचुरी। नाउ वी ऑल नो बिफोर 1947 इंडिया वॉज अंडर द रूल ऑफ ब्रिटिशर्स, राइट? एंड फ्रॉम 20th सेंचुरी द ब्रिटिशर्स स्टार्टेड टेकिंग इंटरेस्ट इन archaeological explorations. Archaeological explorations means what? The old ancient sites were detected, and at those sites excavations were done to find the remains of old cities or old monuments, sculptures, inscriptions, etc. Okay, such excavations were done by the Britishers, and it started in the 20th century. Now the research which was started, that organization was called as Archaeological Survey of India, and the first director general of Archaeological Survey of India was Sir Alexander Cunningham was the first director general of Archaeological Survey of India. Now a number of ancient sites were excavated under his supervision. Okay, now this person specially chose those sites which were mentioned in the Buddhist text. In the Buddhist text, certain places were mentioned, and these places were chosen by Sir Alexander Cunningham for carrying out excavations and to do the archaeological research and survey. Now in the later part, when Sir John Marshall, under the guidance of Sir John Marshall, Harappan civilization was found, and it was really a path breaking discovery, because after the study of Harappan civilization of Mohenjo-daro and Harappa, the Indian civilization, Indian history could be dated back to the 3rd millennium BCE, means 3000 BCE. Okay, we were not having any idea earlier about Indian history, but because of the Harappan civilization, which was discovered by, under the guidance of Sir John Marshall, the Indian history could be dated back to 3rd millennium, that is 3000 BCE or earlier than that. So this particular discovery of Harappan sites was a path breaking thing in Indian historiography. Now, as I told you, these two names you remember. The first director general was Sir Alexander Cunningham, and under whose guidance were the Harappan sites discovered? Sir John Marshall. Okay, now let's talk about the historians under the British rule. Now first of all, I will make you understand the idea of colonialism. Okay, now what is meaning of colonialism? See, the many countries of the world were under the control, economic as well as political control, of the Europeans. Which European countries? Especially England and France. Okay, literally more than half of the countries of the world were under the control of the Britishers, including India. Okay, we know India, Sri Lanka, then Myanmar, all our neighboring countries were under the rule of what? British or the French or the Dutch. In India, mainly Britishers, then Portuguese, French had control over some parts of India. A major part was under the rule of what? Britishers. And Dutch, French, Portuguese had a small region under their control. Now India was a colony of Britishers. Okay, Britishers didn't give treat Indians with equality. They never treated Indians with what? Equality. They considered Indians as their slaves. Understood? And India was looked upon by Britishers as a territory only to make profits. they were not interested in the concepts of equality, democracy or other fundamental rights. Understood? And so the Indian colony, which was ruled by the Britishers, was simply a region to earn maximum profits. This was the concept of what colonialism. And European countries like England and France were at the forefront to capture different regions around the world and bring them under their control. This is the idea of what colonialism. And the British officers who started writing history of India, they were also having the same mindset. They looked upon Indians not with respect. Understood? And that's why the history which was written by British officers or Britishers was lacking some basic things. Okay? They never showed Indian culture, Indian traditions in good light. Okay? They always criticized Indian culture, because these people were Europeans, they followed Christianity, and that's why they were against the culture or traditions followed by the Indians. And these things are reflected in the history written by British officers. So this is the idea I'm giving you, and later on I will talk about the different British historians who wrote the different books. Now the first British historian who wrote a book on Indian history was James Mill. In 1817, James Mill had published 3 volumes of the books History of British India. I repeat, James Mill was the first British historian to write about Indian history, and he published 3 volumes of books, and the name of the book were The History of British India, and he published them in 1817. Now, one big drawback I'll tell you about this book, okay, or this writer, James Mill. The book reflects the absence of objective perspective, and it reflects his prejudice. Prejudice means what? A feeling of negativity against some person. Okay? Prejudice of Indian culture or Indian traditions. All these things are clearly reflected in his writings. James Mill wrote 3 books, but they lacked objective perspective, and there was prejudice against Indian culture. Okay, that was about James Mill. Now one more British officer, he was actually the governor of Mumbai or governor of Bombay, Mount Stuart Elphinstone. This person wrote the book The History of India in 1841. Okay, so even this, his name is important. Mount Stuart Elphinstone wrote, he was a governor of Bombay, and he wrote the book The History of India in 1841. Okay, now in Maharashtra we specially talk about the Maratha rulers, and the Maratha rulers or the Maratha Empire had a great history. We all know about the great Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj or the other rulers who ruled over Maharashtra. And one historian, British historian, British officer, Grant Duff, he wrote about Maratha history. Okay, he wrote about Maratha history. He wrote 3 volumes of History of Marathas. How many books? 3 volumes he wrote. The name was History of the Marathas. But again, the same mindset, this person also condemned the Indian traditions, Indian culture and Indian history. Okay, so although these people wrote about the Maratha Empire or Maratha history, but their writings were not impartial. They were biased. They were what? Biased. And that's why the proper mindset, they didn't write with proper mindset, and that's why there were many drawbacks in these historians, in the writings of these historians. That was Grant Duff. Okay. Similarly, one more officer, Colonel Todd. wrote history of Rajasthan, and it also showcases the same mindset to criticize the Indian culture or Indian traditions, etc. Okay, that was Colonel Todd. But one exception was there, Wilson Hunter also wrote 2 volumes of Indian history, but his writing was impartial. Getting my point? He was to a great extent impartial, and without partiality, without bias nature, he wrote the 2 volumes on Indian history. Who? Wilson Hunter. So I repeat all the names. First, I told about James Mill. Second, Mount Stuart Elphinstone. I told you James Mill was the first British historian to write about Indian history. Then Mount Stuart Elphinstone also wrote about history of India, and he was a governor of Bombay. Then Grant Duff, he wrote about Maratha history, history of Marathas. But again, there was bias. His writings were biased. Colonel Todd wrote about history of Rajasthan. But Wilson Hunter's 2 volumes were written properly, nicely, without any bias. Now, there were some Indian historians at that time who critically analyzed these books, and they wanted to expose the wrong writings, or the they wanted to expose the partiality done by the British writers, especially Grant Duff. Grant Duff had written things, improper things about Maratha history, and to expose him, 2 Indian historians made a thorough research study, and they exposed Grant Duff's writing. These 2 Indian historians were Nilkant Janardhan Kirtane, and second was Vishwanath Kashinath Rajwade. I repeat, these 2 Indian historians exposed the writings of limitations of Grant Duff. Okay, these were Nilkant Janardhan Kirtane, and second was Vishwanath Kashinath Ranade. Vishwanath Kashinath Rajwade. These were Indian historians who exposed the shortcomings of Grant Duff's book. Okay, let's understand this on the board. See, the archaeological exploration and research was started in British rule in 20th century. A number of ancient sites were excavated under supervision of Sir Alexander Cunningham, who was the Director General of Archaeological Survey of India. And specially the sites mentioned in Buddhist texts were chosen by Sir Alexander Cunningham. But later on, Harappan civilization was discovered during the tenure of Sir John Marshall, and it was very helpful discovery, because the Indian history could be traced back to the 3rd millennium BCE after the study of Harappan artifacts or the Harappan civilization. Okay. Now, many British officers wrote about Indian history, but their writings display a strong influence of colonial policies of British. Now, first British historian who wrote about Indian history was James Mill. He wrote 3 volumes of History of British India in 1873. But it reflects absence of objective perspective and prejudice about Indian culture. Okay, James Mill. Second was Mount Stuart Elphinstone, Governor of Bombay. In 1841, he published the book The History of India. The Marathas had a vast history. The Maratha Empire had a vast history, and that's why there was a need to write about history of Marathas. And Grant Duff, British officer, took the initiative, and he wrote 3 volumes of History of Marathas. But again, his writings would reflect the partiality, and he would condemn Indian culture in his books. Colonel Todd's history of Rajasthan shows similar tendency. Okay, but Wilson Hunter wrote two volumes of Indian history and it shows impartial treatment. Okay, Wilson Hunter. Now, all these British writers, most of the British writers had, you can say, shown prejudice against Indian culture, Indian traditions, except Wilson Hunter. Now, there was a need to expose these people. Two Indian historians, Nilkanth Janardhan Kirtani and Vishwanath Kashinath Rajwade, these people took the initiative, they critically analyzed the documents and they finally tried to expose the limitations of Grant Duff's writing. Welcome back. We were studying the second chapter, Historiography, Indian Tradition. Today we'll talk about the Indian historiography and the various ideological frameworks. Now, different historians wrote history based on different ideologies, okay, different mindsets. And we classify Indian historiography into three mindsets or three frameworks. One is called as colonialist historiography. Second is called as orientalist historiography. And third is called as nationalist historiography. So the first one is colonialist historiography. I'll explain you. Earlier I have told you that the British scholars, okay, were the first to write about Indian history, correct? Now these Britishers who came from Europe, they were Christians, and some scholars were actually Christian missionaries. Now what is meant by Christian missionary? These Christian missionaries are entitled, they are given a duty to spread Christianity, and obviously they will not say good things about other religions. The same thing happened here. Those scholars, okay, who wrote the Indian history were either British officers or Christian missionaries, and they, in their writings, they ridiculed Indian culture, and this prejudice can be clearly seen or clearly reflected in their writings. Okay, so this particular type of historiography is called as colonialist historiography, in which the Britishers, British officers or the missionaries ridiculed and criticized Indian culture, Indian religion, Indian practices, and they tried to justify the colonialism. Colonialism means, I told you in earlier video, that a particular rich country, powerful country, dominates and controls a small, weak nation. India was controlled by the Britishers. So India was a colony of British. So they justified colonialism. And between 1922 and 1937, five volumes of Cambridge History of India were written. Okay? 5 volumes of these books were written, Cambridge History of India. And if you read these books, it clearly depicts their mindset, okay, colonialist mindset. And this was a perfect example. These 5 volumes of Cambridge History of India is a perfect example of how, a good example of how the Britishers had prejudice against Indian culture or Indian traditions. Okay, so this particular historiography is called as colonialist historiography. Second is orientalist historiography. Now, there were certain European scholars or historians who were curious to know about the East. East means what? Asia, and especially about what? India. They were curious to know about the civilizations of India, civilizations which took place in India in the past, and they wanted to more about its literature and culture. And these people specially felt admiration and respect for the culture of India or culture of Asia, specifically India, okay? And these people, these scholars were called as Orientalists. They were called as what? Orientalists. Now, these Orientalists studied Sanskrit. Okay? Sanskrit. And they compared Sanskrit with what European languages. They came to know that there is a big similarity between what the European languages like French or German and other languages with Sanskrit. Okay? And these scholars specially focused more on the Vedic tradition and Sanskrit literature. Are you understanding? These European scholars focused more on what? Vedic traditions and Sanskrit literature. Now, the studies resulted in formulating an idea. After all these studies, they came to a conclusion that there is one language, ancient language, which is mother of all Indo-European languages. Okay? They got similarity between Sanskrit and European languages, and they came to a conclusion that there is one ancient language which is the mother of all European languages. This was an idea which was proposed by the European scholars who are called as Orientalists. They are called as what? Orientalists. Now, let's talk about some Orientalists who have contributed greatly to Indian historiography. The first name is Sir William Jones. Okay? This person started the Asiatic Society in Kolkata. Now, this Asiatic Society was started in Kolkata to do research on ancient Indian literature and history. Imagine, a Britisher had started an institute for the study of Indian literature and Indian history. And that was started in Kolkata. The name of the society was the Asiatic Society. Founder was Sir William Jones. Okay. Second, the person who literally has done a great contribution to Indian historiography is Friedrich Max Müller. Okay. He was a German. Okay. This scholar, Friedrich Max Müller, greatly contributed to Indian historiography. This person was of the opinion that the Sanskrit language was the most ancient language of all Indo-European languages. I repeat, the Sanskrit language is the most ancient language amongst the Indo-European languages. And this person was deeply interested in what? Sanskrit literature. What he did? The famous Sanskrit literature, Hitopadesh was translated by this person in German language. Okay, then he edited 50 volumes of books named the Sacred Books of East. Naturally, these books were related with what? Ancient Indian literature. So he was the editor of 50 volumes of which book? The Sacred Books of East. Now, one more contribution. We all know about Rig Veda. Okay? He published 5 volumes of Rig Veda. He compiled 5 volumes of Rig Veda, and later on he translated this Rig Veda, these books of Rig Veda in German language. Okay? This was the greatest contribution by a foreigner towards this ancient language, that is Sanskrit. I repeat, I am talking about Friedrich Max Müller. He was a German scholar, an Orientalist, and his contribution is really appreciable. First of all, he was of the opinion that Sanskrit was the mother of all Indo-European languages. Okay? This person was deeply interested in Sanskrit literature. What he did? The famous Sanskrit literature, Hitopadesh, was translated by this person into German language. Then he was the editor of 50 volumes of books. Imagine, 50 volumes of books were edited by him, and the name of the book was The Sacred Books of East. He compiled Rig Veda and published 5 volumes of Rig Veda. And not only that, he translated Rig Veda in German language. Okay? This was a notable contribution of Friedrich Max Müller, a German scholar or German Orientalist. Now, the third type of historiography is nothing but nationalist historiography. See, as I told you, the Britishers had written history of India. But the Britishers had kept in mind one idea that they should always target Indian culture. They will always criticize Indian culture. Okay, and that was wrong. That was totally wrong. So Indian historians, they who were educated under British education system, okay, they were trained under British education system, they tried to restore the pride and ancient glory of India and the self-esteem of the Indian readers. Are you understanding? These Indian historians who were trained, who were educated in British education system, tried to restore the glory, ancient glory of India through their writings. They made research and finally they wrote their own books on Indian history, exposing how British historians tried to criticize or tried to malign Indian culture. And that type of history really helped to raise the self-esteem of what? Self-respect of Indians. And this type of historiography, which proved very helpful during the Indian freedom struggle, is called nationalistic historiography. Okay, I will talk about this in detail. But these three types of historiographies we understand. First is what? Colonial historiography. Second is Orientalist historiography, and third is the nationalistic historiography. So we come to the nationalistic historiography. As I told you, the main intention was to awaken the Indians and to raise their self-esteem or self-respect. Now in Maharashtra, the person who led this nationalistic historiography was Vishnu Shastri Chiplunkar. And he inspired a number of nationalist historians through his writings. Now he criticized the prejudiced history of ancient India written by British officers. Getting it? As I told you earlier, British officers had written the Indian history with prejudice, and they would ridicule and criticize the Indian culture. And Vishnu Shastri Chiplunkar was against this. And so in his writing, he condemned and criticized the British officers and exposed their prejudice. Now, national historians tried to seek the golden era of Indian history. How India was rich, how India was prosperous before the British rule. These things were focused in Indian national historiography. Okay. Now, many times these Indian nationalist historians have been blamed that they have ignored sometimes about the critical analysis of history. In their writings, sometimes they are blamed that they have not made critical analysis of their writings. Now, some famous nationalist historians were Mahadev Govind Ranade, okay, Vinayak Damodar Savarkar. These two names will always remember: Mahadev Govind Ranade, Vinayak Damodar Savarkar, Rajendra Lal Mishra, Kashi Prasad Jaiswal. What? Kashi Prasad Jaiswal, Anant Sadashiv Altekar, Vasudev Vishnu Mirashi, Radha Kumud Banerjee, Ramkrishna Gopal Bhandarkar. Okay, so at least five I am telling you. First, I told you Mahadev Govind Ranade, Vinayak Damodar Savarkar. These two you remember. Then Ramkrishna Gopal Bhandarkar and Rajendra Lal Mishra, Kashi Prasad Jaiswal. At least four to five you put in your mind. Okay, and remember these names. These were nationalist historians. Now, one famous personality during that time a historian and a very noted scholar was V.K. Rajwade, which I have mentioned earlier also. Okay. Now, V.K. Rajwade, he wrote books on varied subjects. He was well known, he was very famous, and he wrote books on a number of subjects, like right from history, linguistic, means languages, etymology, grammar, etc. Okay. And he was of the opinion that he was of the firm opinion that we should write our own history. Now, what is the meaning behind the sentence? We should write our own history. Actually, he was pointing towards the Britishers. Indian history was written by Britishers. That was wrong. He said that Indians should write their own history, not Britishers. Okay. So he was of the opinion that we should write our own history. Now, he compiled 22 volumes of the book in which he wrote the history of Maratha Empire, and the name of the books was Marathyancha Itihasachi Sadhane. Marathyancha Itihasachi Sadhane. 22 volumes were written by him, and based on the history of Maratha Empire. Okay. Now, for each volume, he wrote a very precise scholarly preface. 22 volumes were there. Each book had a preface, and he wrote a precisely and very scholarly preface for each of the 22 volumes. Now, not only this, Rajwade said that history is all inclusive of the past images of past societies. Means in history we should focus more on past societies. Okay, so that we can understand the transitions, changes which have happened. And he said that it should not simply include the stories of political images or conspiracies and wars to seize the power. These things were important, but not a total part of history. We should have, along with this, we should also focus on the image of our past societies. Now, he also insisted that the history should be written in such a way that we should use authentic documentary source. The documents which we obtain for writing history should be authentic, genuine, okay? They should not be fake. So these were the ideas of V.K. Rajwade. If a short note comes, you have to write all these things about V.K. Rajwade. Okay, how he was a scholar and how he wrote on different subjects. He wrote 22 volumes on Marathyancha Itihasachi Sadhane, and for each book he gave a detailed preface. He was of the opinion, firm opinion, that history should be written by us. We should write history and not the outsiders. Outsiders means Britishers. And he said that history should be an all-inclusive image of our past societies and not simply about wars and conspiracies. And he insisted that history should be written using authentic documents and genuine documents. Okay. Now, in national historiography, or you can say national historiography helped in triggering the Indian independence struggle against the British. It helped in awakening the people to fight unitedly against the Britishers. And one such book should be mentioned. It was written by Vinayak Damodar Savarkar. And this book was The Indian War of Independence, 1857. We all know about the uprising of 1857. Okay? You know about Rani Lakshmibai, Tatya Tope, then Mangal Pandey, these heroes of this uprising. Okay, and many more were there. This person, Vinayak Damodar Savarkar, wrote the book The Indian War of Independence, and it greatly helped in awakening the masses and to start a fight against what? The British Empire. Now, the nationalist historiography gave a momentum to writing regional histories. Earlier, we were writing histories based on total India. Okay? But now, historians started writing history of those regions. That was called as regional history. And hence, attention of historians was drawn to geography conditions and history of South India. If you see carefully, now mostly history is in India is linked with what? The rulers of North. And very less attention is given to what? History of South India. But now the conditions changed. Historians now started focusing on the South India, the geographical conditions and also the history of South India. This was the effect of nationalist historiography. Okay, hope these all points are clear. What you have to do, you have to hear these videos again and again. The more you hear the videos, more the concepts will be clear in your mind. No need to by heart all the things from the textbook. If you hear the videos 2 times a day, okay, all the things will be clear, crystal clear in your mind, and you can answer any question from the textbook. Okay?